Hello and welcome to Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rahman. Our guest today is an independent producer, Ms. Mara Ahmed, who has produced three different documentary films based on her own experience as well as observations in this country, in the United States of America. Mara, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank
in
you.
Our studios, all the way from Rochester to Washington, D.C.,
and
especially in this holiday season. So we welcome you.
Thanks
so much. Let's start with your most recent work, which you just produced in 2015, actually this year, in April of 2015.
Yes.
And it's called A Thin Wall. Mm-hmm. Tell us about this movie before I don't want to be a spoiler.
So it's A Thin Wall is a film about the partition of India. Mm-hmm. And the background of the film is that I was actually taking a workshop in filmmaking at RIT, the Rochester Institute of Technology, mm-hmm. in Rochester. And I was screening my first film, which was called The Muslims I Know, in front of the film department faculty, and they were
which
going
was
to
like 2008, right?
That was 2008,
yeah.
So
quite
it
a
was
few years ago.
Yes, yes. So I was screening it for the faculty, and they were going to give me feedback, mm-hmm. on the rough cut. Mm-hmm. And this other young woman who was studying at RIT, Surbi Diwan, mm-hmm. Approached me and said, I'm from India, but my family is actually from Pakistan.
Surbi is from India. And
she's based in New, mm-hmm. Delhi. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, I'm from Pakistan originally, but my mother's family is from India. And so immediately we started talking about the partition. And that was kind of the genesis of this whole film, the beginning of, mm-hmm. Of the whole film.
So it's a 65-minute long movie, and basically it addresses some of the issues, including violence, which happened during this painful time of that piece of land, actually. So, but what's your basically premise? Why did you think that, you know, what could you add to something which was already been, has been discussed threadbare, lots of books have been written.
True.
Commercial movies have been made on both sides, India, Pakistan, as well as some, you know, Hollywood movies, actually.
Yes.
So why do you feel compelled to do something like this, mm-hmm. All over again?
That's a really good question, because it's true, so much has been written about the partition, so many books, music. I mean, it's obviously something that's very important to that part of the world. And what Surbi and I felt that we wanted to contribute to this huge ongoing process, in a way, of reconciliation, that's the way we see it, is our own personal stories from our own families. So the film is not really a detailed or sweeping historical account of what happened, because I think in most of the books, that's the way partition has been treated, as a political thing. We wanted to really focus on the human stories, and we wanted the film to be very intimate and very personal, which is something different.
And then for a change, you made your own family the main characters,
yes.
in the movie. I mean,
yes.
for example, your mother,
yes.
from your side, and of course, Surbi's family
as well. So we actually focused on our families and the stories and the, in a way, the partition legacy that we grew up with. Because I grew up with these stories, you know, I know everything about my mother's journey on a train, the special train that went from India and crossed the border into Pakistan, and how there were blood stains and how terrified they were.
Punjab, from Amritsar to Lahore.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I mean, we grew up, and Surbi the same thing. She grew up with these stories as well.
Surbi's family was from where in Pakistan?
So they're from different parts. Some of her family was in Lahore. Mm-hmm. Some of her family was in Lailpur.
I see. So mostly Punjab.
Yes, okay. Mostly in the Punjab. Yes.
How did you talk your mother into doing this thing for you?
I mean,
Must have been a major issue.
No, it wasn't. Okay. My mother is actually a very social, mm-hmm. and a very chatty person, and she was more than happy to talk about these things that, like I said, you know, I'm very familiar with them, and I grew up with all of this myth, you know. Mm-hmm. So she was very happy to talk about it.
She could speak from her first-hand experience, not hearsay or just observation.
And the interesting thing about my mom is that she was only 5 years old when the partition happened. So you would think that she wouldn't remember that much. But it's so interesting to me that she remembers everything so vividly and in minute detail. And I feel like perhaps the trauma of partition was such that it's really imprinted on her memory. It's really something that's very vivid and real for her, even though she was a small child.
On both sides, did they also consider the political dimension of this, this event, this huge event in the history?
You mean the people who were interviewed?
Yes, I mean both. I mean your mother and Surbhi's side.
Surbhi's side.
What was the political reason, the background of this thing? Because I'm sure when you talk about, you cannot just escape the fact. There was a lot of politics involved.
Of course.
There was huge leaders, larger than lives.
Yes.
Leaders were involved.
Yes.
In the whole process. So it's not just a tragedy like a massacre or a genocide or what happened in Congo and other places or Sudan. I mean, it went through a very intense political process.
Yes.
And what happened actually, most of the violence happened after the fact when the migration started.
Yes.
Happening on both sides.
Yes.
Other than that, the whole process was very peaceful. Leaders, sat down on the table and they decided, yes, this is the boundary and yes, you're going to take care of this. But after, so did you consider those aspects as well?
Yes, in the film we do talk about some of that political context, because every tragedy happens within a context which many times is very political. And so I think it's very important to be able to fill in those blanks. It's very important to understand that so that such tragedies are not repeated. And that's why I think that the film is not just for India and Pakistan. The film is very universal, because a lot of the issues that happened and a lot of the things like, for example, colonialism, imperialism, ethnic cleansing, the making of refugees, national borders, nation states, which is a modern concept actually. All of these things are still extremely relevant to this day. So civil war, things like that. So I feel that it's a very important, a very violent, but very important template, historical template, for us to understand a lot of the things that are happening in the world right now. Mm-hmm. So we do touch on that. Now, our interviewees sometimes did mention some of these political personalities, mm-hmm. larger than life personalities that you're talking about, but it's not what we focused on. We really focused on the human stories because we think that's so important. Mm-hmm. An interesting thing about the film is that because it's shot on both sides of the border, it's shot in Lahore, mm-hmm. and it's shot in New Delhi.
Surbhi's town, I suppose.
Surbhi is based in New Delhi, and my family is mostly based in Lahore. But when you get introduced to a character in the film, initially you get some information about their location, where they're from and where they moved from, where they immigrated from. However, that information you only get the first time that you meet them on screen. After that, you don't get that information anymore. And many people said to me in the middle of the film and towards the end, it was very hard to tell who was Indian and who was Pakistani. And that's something that I wanted very much to do in the film, because the stories are so similar. They look the same, they sound the same, they're telling the same stories. They're talking about their homes, they're talking about this disruption that happened in their lives. And that's what we wanted to focus on.
Very good. I can't believe the time is flying so fast. It's been a very interesting discussion. But we have to take a short break. After we come back, we'll talk about, what you see, the stories, those. They basically were the effect of a cause.
Yes.
Did you also discuss the cause of partition?
Sure.
So we'll discuss it after we come back. Stay with us, please.
The first census that happened in the 1800s was really the first time that people were asked to fit into a particular religious box. So it's the first time that they had to describe themselves as Hindu or Muslim.
Welcome back. I'm Faiz Rahman. You're watching Cafe DC. Our guest today is Mara Ahmed, and she is an independent producer, a documentary producer. Once again, welcome back, Mara. So we were talking about these stories, magnificent, tragic, lots of violence, of course, those stories bring out. But those stories were the effect of a huge event.
Mm-hmm.
Did you also discuss the cause of that event?
Yeah, we talk about it. Again, you know, we didn't want the film to be very political, so that's something very deliberate. But like I said, it's important to provide some political context about why partition happened. Different ways of understanding it. And so we do talk about, for example, the fact that it was very much embedded in colonialism. And that, for example, the first census that happened in India, and when I say India, I mean the Indian subcontinent. The first census that happened in the 1800s was really the first time that people were asked to fit into a particular religious box. Mm-hmm. So it's the first time that they had to describe themselves as Hindu or Muslim
that
or Sikh.
That probably happened the first time in the world, entire world. I don't think anywhere else people were boxed based on their religion.
But you know, the interesting thing is, and you did mention earlier, you mentioned Rwanda, for example. Mm-hmm. It's interesting that the same thing happened in Rwanda as well. Mm-hmm. So the Dutch colonizers and then later the Belgian mm-hmm. colonizers also for the first time in a way classified people as Hutu and Tutsi and kind of favored one group over the other and created divisions then that lasted for a long time and then that played out later mm-hmm. in a very violent way.
I mean, this is a very scary times for a lot of people around the world. I mean, there's a lot of violence, and what you just brought up, Mara, is very significant, very, very significant. What you're saying is actually the seeds of partition mm-hmm. and the division were sown when this census took place in the 1800s, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because then people were put into database based on their religion, ethnicity, and all kinds of, you know,
yes.
divisions. And you know what happened later in other parts of the world, in Germany, and unfortunately there are some politicians here, even in this country, who are not talking about creating some kind of a database for Muslims.
Yes.
So of course you're an American, a wonderful American, you're making such a great contribution to this country, this society, the diversity, you know. When you hear all this nonsense
yes.
in the media and from some very important and responsible leaders,
yes.
do you have a flashback
yes.
to some of those moments that you went through when you were producing this movie?
Absolutely. I mean, like I said, that's why I feel that the film is really important mm-hmm. and it's really universal and in a way timeless because we are still struggling with all these issues. And just like the United States, India too was historically, if you look at ancient history in India, mm-hmm. has always been a deeply multi-religious, deeply multi-ethnic place where people, I'm not saying that there's never any conflict between people. Of course, it's natural. Conflict is a natural thing that happens when, you know, even within the same family it happens, right? So yes, there was conflict. I'm not saying that it was always perfect and peachy, but people were still able to coexist and they coexisted for centuries. For long periods of time. And so that was the very nature of India, that it was so mixed together. And it's interesting that Rabindranath Tagore, for example, in 1917, wrote a very interesting essay on nationalism and critiques nationalism, Western-style nationalism, which he feels is very siloed and divides people into different, these neat categories. Which he feels that kind of division is not something that will work for India. It's not a natural fit for India. So even in 1917, he's talking about that.
Yeah, the Nobel laureate, the first in that region, that
yes.
part of the world.
Yeah. And so actually in the film, we do that. We talk about all of the stuff that happened when these divisions, you know, became very solidified and how politicians also kind of played off of those divisions and then, you know, of course, the horrible and violent consequences of that. And then all of a sudden, when I'm showing people in Pakistan, I also switch to footage of people shot in New York. Because again, New York is a place, New York City is very diverse, it's very multi-ethnic, very multi-religious. And I wanted people to be able to kind of, not to be so far removed from what happened in India because it's on the other side of the planet and because it was in 1947. I wanted them to realize how important that is because even to this day, we have very, very mixed, very multi-ethnic spaces, right, and places in the world. And what would happen if something, you know, if those kinds of divisions and those kinds of lines were drawn in these spaces.
I see.
It would be horrible.
Mara, I mean, of course, partition was a huge, whatever it was, but it was also a huge political event. Mm-hmm. And when you discuss this, of course, there has to be some political takeaway.
Right.
It's not a political question, but if an independent person is watching your movie, what would be his or her takeaway? Partition was good, partition was bad, it was inevitable, or maybe necessary, or you know, there was no other choice. So in just like two or three words, if you can give us that takeaway,
yes.
Or take a few more words, it's fine.
Yes.
So what do you think?
I think the film kind of makes you suspicious of the whole idea of nationalism. And the whole idea of national borders, which, like I said before, is actually a contemporary idea. And so I feel that after a line was drawn, after partition happened in 1947, it's almost like when you do that, then people on both sides of the border feel that they have to redefine themselves in a more homogenous, in a more nationalistic way.
On both sides.
On
yes.
both sides.
Mm-hmm. What it means to be a Pakistani and what
it does
means
it mean to be
an Indian.
And being Pakistani, does it mean that you have to be a Muslim? And mm-hmm. being mm-hmm. Indian, does it mean that you have to be a Hindu? Mm-hmm. And you are seeing these scenarios being played out in both countries. So, I think that nationalism is something that we should question sometimes, because I think that first and foremost, we are human beings and we are citizens of the world. That's the way I see myself. And so, creating these aberrations, historical aberrations, where people have to be a specific way in order to fit a certain mold and be a certain nationality, I think doesn't really work, because human beings don't work
right.
that way.
Mara, I mean, before you were a producer, I think looking at your work and reading about you, I get a sense that you have a deep sense of, doing something for the society as an activist. Mm-hmm. And then you chose this vehicle.
Yes.
And of course, in your opinion, and lots of people feel that way, that movies are some of the most effective, most
yes.
powerful ways of communication.
Yes.
So again, yes, you made a statement. But now partition is a fact.
Mm-hmm.
What's your advice to the people on both sides?
Mm-hmm.
How can they make things better mm-hmm. for themselves and for their children and for their progeny, people to come, after,
Yes, so in the film, I think what we express is a hope that we're not saying that we want to reverse the partition. Like you said, it's already been done and so much history has happened after that. That is probably not something that can be reversed completely. But we do hope for more open borders. We do hope for more traveling across the border, mm-hmm. for more collaboration, maybe artistic projects or business projects or cultural projects, where people can work together and meet one another and really get to know one another for who they are. We feel that we have so much history in common, so much culture in common. And Indians are always interested in, for example, Pakistani dramas, and Pakistanis are always interested in Indian movies. So of course we share this culture that, everyone likes Lata Mangeshkar songs, what I mean?
Or and they like Mehdi Hassan and Ghulam Ali.
And they love Mehdi Hassan and Noor Jahan.
Yeah,
they love her even more than the Pakistanis do.
Exactly.
So I just think that there's so much in common.
So what's the impediment, you think? Yes, these are all very noble ideas and goals, but you don't see them happening on the ground.
Yeah,
what's the reason, in your opinion? Why?
My opinion is that, of course...
Again, it's a political question, but you're
yes,
more than
welcome. Yes, but I think that there are political mm-hmm. reasons why this doesn't happen, because okay. anyone that I've ever
Who is
met,
at fault?
I think the politicians and mm-hmm. the way that...
On
the
both sides?
On both sides. Mm-hmm. And the way that states function,
mm-hmm.
because that's there is the need for this hostility, for this separation,
mm-hmm.
And the elite in mm-hmm. both countries benefit from that.
Yeah, you mentioned colonialism as one of the reasons for this tragedy.
Yes,
or this event, to use neutral language. But do you also see the legacy of colonialism behind some of these current issues? Then why people can't come together? It's also because some of the things that were done in India by the colonial masters are still causing
Well, yeah, it's not just, I mean, colonialism, I think, was the beginning of what ended with the partition, mm-hmm. right?
And then,
of course, when you had these two nation states and they were constantly at war with each other, so there have been a lot of wars between these two countries. Then, of course, that history also becomes part of the background of separation.
What's your next move? Another movie, or you want to be part of some other, you know, projects in Pakistan?
I'm actually thinking about doing a project on racism.
Okay. So, and again, a movie, a documentary?
I'm thinking of some kind of multimedia thing, which is very community-based and where there's interaction.
Racism here in this country?
Yes.
The United States of America?
Yes, okay. Which I think is an important subject. Okay. And so, I'm thinking of collaborating with another filmmaker and making it with that person.
I have a few more minutes, and I think we should also talk about your previous work.
Yes.
The Muslims I Know, and also Pakistan One-on-One. Tell us about those two documentaries as well.
So my first documentary, The Muslims I Know, came out in 2008. Mm-hmm. And I always tell people that I became a filmmaker in order to make that film. Mm-hmm. So my background is actually in finance and economics. And I've always worked in finance. Mm-hmm. But in 2004, I quit my job. And I began taking classes in art, because art is my passion. I've always loved art. And then later, in 2006, I started thinking about making a film, and the reason was very specific. After 9/11, I just felt that mainstream media there was this barrage of misinformation about Islam and Muslims, which was coming out of mainstream media. And it just became very difficult for me to even watch the news or read a newspaper, because it would just make my blood boil, because I felt so far removed from what I knew as a Muslim, mm-hmm. and all the other Muslims that I knew, which was a lot of people. And so I said to my husband, someone really needs to make a film which counters all this misinformation and which shows Muslims the way that they are and kind of gives them a platform to be a part of this conversation. Because mm-hmm. people were talking about Muslims, but Muslims were not part of that conversation. Mm-hmm. And not that they didn't want to, mm-hmm. but they were not allowed to be a part of the discourse.
Do you see a little improvement on that situation? I see a few more voices in the mainstream media on behalf of Muslims, and actually some Muslim voices. Did you notice some improvement on that, or still?
No, unfortunately.
You still think, okay.
No. Unfortunately, I find that it's called the Islamophobia industry, because there is actually a lot of money invested in the kind of propaganda that comes from a lot of mainstream media, and I feel that that industry has become more established over time. Mm-hmm. And so it's even more difficult now to go against it and present something different.
But again, as I said before, you see people countering what Mr. Trump has been saying about, I hope you weren't one of them, you know, like in New Jersey, rejoicing, God forbid, the attacks of, you know, 9/11. But he's kind of, you know, constantly repeating those allegations. But I have seen mainstream media anchors who are not just basically countering his views, but also producing some witnesses that is totally, you know, not true. Mm-hmm. And also have seen Washington Post, New York Times, they have written some good articles. Again, being someone who's been here in this country for a very long time and
yeah.
who's been through all these stages and phases, this is my own personal observation that I see some improvement on media voices. Being a little bit more inclusive and some, but please don't take it as if your work's been done. You should continue to do this wonderful work that you've been doing.
I just wanted to add, we were talking about the 9/11 attacks. I was actually affected by them in a more personal way than mm-hmm. most Americans.
Please, yeah.
So my husband was working in New York City that day, he's a physician, mm-hmm. and we lived in that area. So, you know, the smoke that was coming out of the towers for months and months afterwards is something that we would see on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. So for me, that was a very devastating event, mm-hmm. and you know, I very much felt a part of the community that had to deal mm-hmm. with the aftermath of what happened. Mm-hmm. So yes, of course. So again, for me, that's a very personal thing. Mm-hmm. It's not something that I just read about in the news. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, there was no rejoicing. There was, in fact, depression for mm-hmm. many months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was in Los Angeles, and I still vividly remember those moments because Los Angeles is 3 hours behind, so it was like early in the morning.
Yeah.
But Mara, you know, you mentioned about this industry, you know, these voices, anti-Muslim voices coming out of because of certain like vested interests, but also Muslims being accused of not doing enough. I mean, that's a constant thing that you see in the media. That, you know, yes, Muslims haven't been out there. They haven't condemned it enough. All these events, whether you talk about 9/11 or all the way to Paris attacks. What's your take on this as a Muslim activist who's been out there actually, not just through some, you know, speeches, but through these solid works, pieces of work. So what is, Jane?
Well, that's why I feel that things have not improved over the years. So from 9/11 when the attacks in New York happened to just a couple of weeks ago when the Paris attacks happened, I mean, that's a lot of time that passed in between. Yet I still feel that today after the Paris attacks, again, Muslims were not allowed to be a part of the conversation that was going on about them. And if so, very few selected Muslim voices. And this constant refrain of Muslims not condemning enough is simply not true. I know, for example, I live in Rochester, New York, and the Islamic Center immediately issued a very long statement. We got personal emails, actually, that we saw in our inbox saying how much they condemn and, you know, that their thoughts are with the families.
Very, very important conversation, but we are out of time. So thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
I really appreciate and wish you all the best and hope your work gets noticed. And
my website.
Website, yeah, please, you are more than welcome to repeat it. Say it on camera.
It's neelumfilms.com. Mm-hmm. So it's neelumfilms.com. And you can learn more about all
please
the films.
Please go on this
we
website and learn. And this was Mara Ahmed talking about her work. Very important topic indeed. See you next week. We're totally out of time. Thank you.